Buenas noches. Good evening to you all. My name is Francisco Menugarte. I am from El Salvador. I was only 6 years old when a civil war began in my country. It lasted for 12 years and claimed the lives of 75,000 people. When that began, my father was a captain in the Salvadoran army. He was ordered to carry out a massacre in the village of El Rosario. If he had obeyed, it would have meant killing some 4,000 civilians. Realizing he couldn't follow such orders, he decided to leave the army and join the opposition to fight against the military regime. That meant that my mother, my two sisters, and I had to flee for our safety. After the war, a United Nations commission documented the kind of atrocities that had led to my father's decision. The commission's report was a chilling account of repression against the people by the government and the military. There were two particular cases that shook the conscience of the world: the assassination of Archbishop Romero in 1980, and the assassination of the Jesuit fathers and their domestic employees that was ordered by the Army High Command. Their murders in 1989 finally forced the U.S. Congress to confront the problem of U.S. complicity in the war. As it was read in this evening's prayer, on November 16, 1989, shortly after midnight, a group of elite soldiers entered the campus of the Jesuit University in San Salvador. Some of them had been trained at the School of the Americas in Fort Benning, Georgia. They ordered the Jesuits out to the garden in front of their residence, made them lie face down, and shot them point blank in the head. Then they executed a Salvadoran mother and daughter who were spending the night in a guest room nearby. Why were the Jesuits assassinated? The Jesuits were assassinated for their unwavering commitment to the impoverished and oppressed. They were assassinated because of their commitment to the preferential option for the poor. We are gathered this weekend to commemorate their lives and to reflect on their example of working for peace with justice. In the past 10 years as executive director of CRISPAS, I've witnessed how the example of the Salvadoran martyrs has shaken and inspired the lives of so many participants in our delegations. What the Jesuits offer us is a powerful message of radical hope and prophetic action. What does radical hope mean? What does it look like? What does it feel like? The people of El Salvador have helped me answer these questions. I've had the good fortune to sit in front of Radical Hope. That is, I've had the honor of meeting a courageous group of women called the Comadres, the Committee of Mothers of the Disappeared. This committee was formed by mothers whose sons and daughters had been captured by El Salvador's death squads. To this day, the majority of them have never been found. Their children were being persecuted for publicly protesting injustices of the military regime. These mothers encountered lies, violence, and death as they searched for their sons and daughters. Some of them ended up being tortured themselves. Mother Alicia was one of the founders of Comadres. She lost two sons. One was only 12 years old, the other was 16. Her daughter was raped and tortured, and she herself was captured when she was 5 months pregnant. The torture they put her through was so violent that she ended up having a miscarriage in prison. It was like that for many mothers, but this did not stop them. They kept on denouncing the injustices and accompanying other mothers with a radical, persistent hope that they would be heard and that they would find their children. What made their hope radical wasn't just what they hoped for. It was what inspired it, what grounded it, what enabled them to believe that things could be different. Certainly, what inspired them and what inspires anyone who has hope is something we feel in ourselves, in our humanity. But at the same time, it is more than that. It's something that enables us to hope when, humanly speaking, there's no reason to hope. This is when we realize that when we connect with the depths of our humanity, we are connecting with something more than we understand humanity to be. Radical hope opens us to what the Jesuits would call the spirit that acts in and through our humanity. And so, for these mothers, radical hope was never about doing something that was sure to have results. It was about not giving up. It was about doing what was right simply because it was right. Hope in such desperate situations can only be a radical hope. The six Jesuits were close to people like these mothers, people who made them more human. They came to know and see the unjust reality that most people in El Salvador were living with. The Jesuits intentionally, purposefully, and passionately addressed the specific causes of the injustices existing at the time, and that meant challenging the status quo. The memory of the martyrs fills our history with their light, but these memories can also be dangerous, in the sense they call upon us, or better yet, they demand of us that we carry on. When we remember what these people have lived and died for, we find ourselves in power to follow their example, and to hope even when there seems no reason to hope. They offer us the gift of radical hope, and that will lead us to prophetic action, to resisting the status quo and the system that's causing the injustice. It will help us find the courage to speak up and resist, even when doing so will be uncomfortable or even dangerous. My dad had a deep friendship with these Jesuits, especially Fathers Ellacuría and Segundo Montes. He also had many conversations with Monsignor Romero. That was what challenged him and inspired him and led him to see that he could no longer ignore the atrocities he witnessed by the military. Those men inspired him to take the prophetic action of abandoning his military post despite the dangerous consequences for him and our family. But how can we sustain this radical hope and prophetic action? Here, the Jesuits would remind us of the need for contemplation. We nurture our radical hope in our spirituality, in our prayer life, in what we call the mystical awareness of the spirit that we feel in private meditation or in community gatherings and prayer. For Christians, and certainly for the Jesuits, Jesuit martyrs, such contemplation is rooted in and animated by the example of Jesus. Filled with and driven by the Spirit, he lived a life of prophetic action that eventually led to his execution by the powers that be. So like Jesus and the Jesuits, we need to engage in both prophetic action and continued contemplation. Contemplation without prophetic action can be self-centered and not go anywhere in terms of helping others. But prophetic action without contemplation can slip into hatred and violence or end up in burnout. We need contemplation to sustain both radical hope and prophetic action. The ability to hope and keep acting when the opposition is overwhelming and nothing seems to change, this comes out of faith, out of what we feel inside ourselves together with others. Such faith usually grows in a community. We sustain each other in this inner conviction that comes out of our connectedness with the energy of the Spirit that animated Jesus. Such spirit energy leads us to prophetic action that may require that we make political choices and take positions. This is something that's so difficult to do nowadays when we're told not to mix politics with religion or when we confuse disagreeing with being disagreeable. To follow the example of the Jesuits and Monsignor Romero and so many other Salvadoran martyrs is to commit ourselves to a path of radical hope and prophetic action. It is a path on which our action will be sustained by our spirituality, and our spirituality will call us to further action. When we respond to issues such as immigration and climate change, we are responding to those who cry out for justice. It is an example of how Christians are to follow Jesus in today's world, a world in which there are millions of people who are suffering. As Christians, we must recognize that we live in a world filled with numerous groups and communities who are facing systematic oppression, and we must act. We have to be willing to identify and engage the complex realities within our world that create such problems. To commit oneself to radical hope and prophetic action is a matter of who we are as disciples and followers of Jesus. It's not a liberal cause or a populist agenda or a mainstream fad. It's a deeply spiritual practice. The dangerous memory of the Jesuit martyrs of Romero and so many Salvadoran martyrs transcends borders and calls us all forward. We cannot do otherwise.